We're going to be in back in Revelation. Last week, we looked at five verses, Revelation 8, 1 through 5. This week, we're going to be looking at two chapters, all of Revelation 8 and all of Revelation 9. I asked my kids on the way over here, what do you think the over-under is on 45 minutes? And I'm not going to tell you what they said. But I am determined to shame them publicly. We're going to be looking at Revelation 8 and 9. Really, 8, 9, 10, and 11 are all one unit, one cycle, so to speak, that all fits together. We're going to take it. If my preaching chops were a little bit more than what they were, maybe I could do all four of them in a shot, but I'm not even going to attempt it. We're going to take it instead in just 2 weeks. Got a lot of text to cover, so let me read. And as we do, you might be startled, confused. You might have questions about weird images and language, about terrifying pictures. And yet all of these, I think, we'll find we will make sense of in Christ. And so with him in mind, consider now the word of the Lord. When the Lamb opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. Then I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and seven trumpets who were given to them. And another angel came and stood at the altar with a golden censer, and he was given much incense to offer with the prayers of all the saints on the golden altar before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints rose before God from the hand of the angel. Then the angel took the censer and filled it with fire from the altar and threw it on the earth. And there were peals of thunder, rumblings, flashes of lightning, and an earthquake. Now the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared to blow them. The first angel blew his trumpet, and there followed hail and fire mixed with blood, and these were thrown upon the earth. And a third of the earth was burned up, and a third of the trees were burned up, and all green grass was burned up. The second angel blew his trumpet, and something like a great mountain burning with fire was thrown into the sea. And a third of the sea became blood. A third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships were destroyed. The third angel blew his trumpet, and a great star fell from heaven, blazing like a torch, and it fell on a third of the rivers and on the springs of the water. The name of the star is Wormwood. And a third of the waters became wormwood, and many people died from the water because it had been made bitter. The fourth angel blew his trumpet, and a third of the sun was struck, and a third of the moon, and a third of the stars, so that a third of their light might be darkened. And a third of the day might be kept from shining, and likewise a third of the night. And then I looked, and I heard an eagle crying with a loud voice as it flew directly overhead, "Woe, woe, woe to those who dwell on the earth at the blasts of the other trumpets that the three angels are about to blow." And then the fifth angel blew his trumpet. And I saw a star fallen from heaven to earth, and he was given the key to the shaft of the bottomless pit. And he opened the shaft, the bottomless pit, and from the shaft rose smoke like the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened with the smoke from the shaft. And then from the smoke came locusts on the earth, and they were given power like the power of scorpions of the earth. And they were told not to harm the grass of the earth or any green plant or any tree, but only those people who do not have the seal of God on their foreheads. And they were allowed to torment them for 5 months, but not to kill them. And their torment was like the torment of a scorpion when it stings someone. And in those days, people will seek death, and they will not find it. They will long to die, but death will flee from them. In appearance, the locusts were like horses prepared for battle, and on their heads were what looked like crowns of gold. Their faces were like human faces, and their hair like women's hair. Their teeth like lion's teeth. They had breastplates like breastplates of iron, and the noise of their wings was like the noise of many chariots with horses rushing into battle. They have tails and stings like scorpions, and their power to hurt people for 5 months is in their tails. They have as a king over them the angel of the bottomless pit. His name in Hebrew is Abaddon, and in Greek he is called Apollyon. The first woe has passed. Behold, two woes are still to come. Then the sixth angel blew his trumpet, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar before God, saying to the sixth angel who had the trumpet, "Release the four angels who are bound at the great river Euphrates." And so the four angels who had been prepared for the hour, the day, the month, and the year were released to kill a third of mankind. The number of mounted troops was twice 10,000 times 10,000, and I heard their number. This is how I saw the horses in my vision and those who rode them. They wore breastplates the color of fire and sapphire and of sulfur, and the heads of the horses were like lions' heads, and fire and smoke and sulfur came out of their mouths. By these three plagues, a third of mankind was killed. By fire and smoke and sulfur coming out of their mouths. For the power of the horses is in their mouths and in their tails. For their tails are like serpents with heads. And by means of them they wound. The rest of mankind, who were not killed by these plagues, did not repent of the works of their hands, nor give up worshiping demons and idols of gold and silver and bronze and stone and wood, which cannot see or hear or walk, nor did they repent of their murders or their sorceries or their sexual immorality or their thefts. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. The big idea really of the passage is this: God answers our prayers by afflicting the world with judgments. Rather simple. It's connecting last week's passage with this week's passage because they go together. God answers our prayers by afflicting the world with his judgments, and we're going to see that those judgments ultimately serve the end of his gospel purposes. It's good news for those who are in Christ. I want to consider these two chapters in 2 points. Point number one, beginning in chapter 8, verse 6, all the way through chapter 9, verse 19, that's the bulk of our passage, I want us to behold God's judgments. We're going to consider two things. We're going to consider, on the one hand, a creation plagued, and we're going to consider, on the other hand, evil run amok. Creation plagued, evil run amok. And then in the last two verses, after we consider man, or rather we consider God's judgments, we're going to consider man's folly. In light of all that he sees God doing in the world, how will he respond? Much of the world will go on just as they are, rejecting God, denying the gospel, scorning his church. One of the challenging things of preaching through books of the Bible is that you can't ultimately skip the passages that at the beginning of a week of preaching preparation you don't really know what to do with. You can't just preach pet sermons. You got to preach the hard parts of the Bible, and that's a good thing. Because there aren't parts of the Bible that are more inspired and parts of the Bible that are less. There aren't parts of the Bible that are more beneficial to us and parts of the Bible that aren't. There's lots of different food groups. They might all nourish us in different ways, and we need all of them to be fully formed followers of Jesus. And yet at the same time, there are parts of the Bible that are easy to understand. All that we need to know about God and his will for salvation to sinners like us, he has made so abundantly clear that a child could know them. And yet at the same time, there are other parts of the Bible that are not so easy to understand. Even the Apostle Peter said of Paul, Paul says hard things. And they're hard to understand. And yet he recognizes that Paul's words are God's words. And we need help from the Holy Spirit and faithful teachers to guide us into those harder parts of the Bible. And so I am actually pleased, excited, and have prayed for God's grace and help to lead us through this perplexing part of the Scriptures. Well, as I was reading through it, you may have noticed that there was all kinds of strange images. Mountains being thrown into the sea, a falling star named Wormwood, scorpions with human faces and women's hair. What do we do with that? How should we read the book of Revelation? Well, let me give you two ways to not read the book. First of all, don't read it chronologically. Here's what I mean by that. Notice, for instance, in chapter 9, verse 4, we have a prohibition against harming the grass, and yet in the previous chapter, chapter 8, verse 7, we see the grass is already burnt up. In chapter 8, verse 10, a star falls from heaven, but in chapter 6, the previous chapters earlier, we see all the stars have fallen from heaven. There were no more stars to fall, so which is it? I think these are just a couple of examples to help us see that these aren't so much a sequence of historical events. This happens, and then afterwards this happens, and then that happens until the end of the age. But it's more like a sequence of dreams. John says, I saw this, and then afterwards I saw that. That's how we should understand the sequencing. So don't read it chronologically. Read it like a dream sequence. Fantastical images that give us a picture, or rather knowledge of, ultimate reality. But secondly, don't read it like a documentary. We don't want to read the book of Revelation like a 60 Minutes magazine, right? We don't want to turn it on and think that we're just narrating things as they are. It's not an eyewitness documentary of historical events. We're not to read the book of Revelation in the same way that we might read the Gospels. The Bible is full of all different kinds of literature. God has inspired human authors to write in their own context, with their own personalities, and in a variety of genres, so that we might be able to understand the truth about who He is and what He's doing in Christ from a variety of perspectives. And if we're talking about the end of the age and all that will come about to the glory of God in both His judgments and in His mercy, there is no better genre in all of Scripture to use than the genre of prophetic or apocalyptic literature. And that's what we have here. The literature that John is using to describe and write down the visions that he saw is full of fantastic imagery. We see it here in Revelation. We see it elsewhere, especially in the prophets of the Old Testament. If you've ever been reading through the Bible and you read through a Bible in a year or five plan, then when you hit those prophets, you go, what is going on? What are they talking about? What are they seeing? Well, what we have here is not so much historical realism, but it's more kind of like CGI. Like Pixar or the MCU, more like that than 60 Minutes. Now, I don't mean it in the sense when I say fantastical that it's untrue. It is like fantasy, but it is ultimate reality. It is ultimate reality presented in pictures. And so you and I, we don't need to imagine that one day we're really going to encounter locusts with women's hair and lion's teeth and breastplates of iron. And nor do you and I need to decode these kinds of images in weird and wonderful ways. For example, you see in Revelation 9, when John sees locusts like scorpions, well, what he's really seeing, as one commentator a number of years ago noted, what he's really seeing is Apache helicopters from China. Because since John has no idea what a helicopter is, and he sees a helicopter, he's a first century man after all, he describes these futuristic machines with images that he knows that are accessible to him. The front of it looks like the head of a grasshopper, only with a human face peering through. And the back is like the tail of a scorpion, and up top is something like women's hair twirling around and around. That's not bad. It's just not true. Rather than imagine these images as something that we can run and capture on our iPhone cameras, we need to realize that most or all of this imagery is taken from the Old Testament. Amos had a vision about locusts. Ezekiel saw coals scattered from God's chariot. Isaiah saw a falling star. And here's what's most important for our passage. The plagues against Egypt in that book of Exodus form the backdrop for most of these two chapters. The book of Revelation is an Old Testament commentary. It helps us understand Old Testament imagery in light of the present reign and the future return of Jesus Christ. Jesus told the Pharisees, "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it is they that bear witness about me." The book of Revelation is bearing witness to Christ and using the Old Testament scriptures to exposit his plans and purposes. And so when we read Revelation, we need to keep in mind that the Old Testament is the front door. Jesus Christ is the key that unlocks it, that opens up to us a world of gospel truth and of the hope and the truth that you and I need in order to persevere in this world until Christ calls us home or comes again. Well, let's consider our first point. I want us to behold God's judgment. Just real quick for context, let's revisit what we considered last week. All the way up at the top of the chapter, chapter 8, verses 2 to 4, we see that trumpets of judgment are handed out, but they are not yet blown. A heavenly silence, deafening silence, fills God's throne room, and incense rises to heavens, the prayers of the saints. And then in verse 5, the angel takes the same censer that he used to perfume the prayers of the saints, and he fills the bowl with coals, with fire, and he throws it down to the earth. So what we see is that after the prayer of God's oppressed people rise up to heaven in verses 3 and 4, God acts on their behalf in verse 5. He answers their prayers and acts. Here's a truth that you and I need to hold on to. It's just a reminder from last week's sermon. If you weren't here, this is maybe fresh news to you, but you need to hold on to it. God hears and receives our prayers in Christ. He's not aloof. He's not distant. He is mindful of us, even and especially in our tribulation for Christ's sake. And God promises to answer our prayers by judging those who oppose his word and who afflict his church, in part now and through this age, until he does so fully and finally when he comes again. His judgments are presented here to John in the image of seven trumpets. Trumpets are always significant in the Old Testament, especially. It's announcing a king's march. It's announcing judgment to come. You remember when the walls of Jericho fell? What was being played just beforehand? The trumpets were. God's victory was coming. Judgment was coming against those who were in the land and who opposed him. And so the trumpets were sounded. Well, here we have seven trumpets. Seven trumpets, just like the seven seals in chapters 6 and 7. Really showing us similar or the same events, but just from a different camera angle. Remember we talked about that? That these are cycles of visions that are helping us understand the reality, the ultimate reality of our world and what it means to be a faithful Christian in it, only from this angle, then from that angle, and then from this other angle, so that we might be able to persevere by faith, knowledgeably in light of Christ. But beginning in verse 6, what we see first of all in God's judgments is a plagued creation. Notice in verses 6 through 12, God's going to see four angels blow four trumpets in quick succession. Much of the imagery that we have here is borrowed from the great Exodus event in the Old Testament. I don't know whether that stood out to any of you as I read through it, but just consider this in verse 7. We have a plague of destructive hailstones and fire, just like we see in Exodus 9. Then in verses 8 and 9, we see a second trumpet. And that second trumpet recalls when Moses put his staff into the Nile in Exodus 7 and turned it to blood, killing every single creature in it. Look at verses 10 and 11, that third trumpet, water too bitter to drink. A few chapters later in Exodus 16, God turned bitter water to sweet water for Moses. Well, here, that blessing is reversed. Whereas with Moses, bitter water was made sweet and drinkable, here we see sweet and drinkable water is made bitter. God is not acting in mercy, he is acting in judgment. Then in verse 12, we see a fourth trumpet. The sun goes dark, just like the plague of darkness in Exodus 10. Why does John lean so heavily into the Exodus imagery? In Exodus chapter 2, Moses writes, quote, "The people of Israel groaned because of their slavery, and they cried out for help. Their cry came up to God." Sound familiar? "It came up to God, and God heard their groaning, and God saw the people of Israel, and God knew." Exodus was an Old Testament blueprint, a sketch of a greater judgment and a greater rescue to come through a greater prophet than Moses. He's given us the blueprints for how he's going to rescue his church through the ages from this present world. In Exodus, God's oppressed people cry out to God, and God responds by judging Egypt through plagues and other powerful signs. Well, here in Revelation 8, God's oppressed people cry out to God, and God responds by treating the whole world just like he treated Egypt, to rescue his people, to protect them and secure them, and to call the world to repentance and faith. But I don't think these first four trumpets speak about God's final judgment. In fact, I think what they're talking about is ongoing judgments in this present age, not that judgment that's going to come when Christ returns, because you'll notice all the way throughout these handful of verses, John repeats that only part of the creation is under judgment. A third, a third, a third, a third. It's not exhaustive in nature. Just like the four horsemen, all the way back in chapter 6, that sermon's up online. If you want to go back and listen to it again, you can do that. The four trumpets in chapter 8 represent God's present anger and wrath against a world that rebels against him, rejects Christ, and persecutes his church. Romans chapter 1, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. Romans 8, God has subjected the creation to futility. These are familiar themes that are going to be portrayed in graphic ways in this chapter. All of creation under God's judgment for its rebellion against its creator. And so what you and I see in the news, stories of hurricanes and tsunamis, of famines and earthquakes and many, many more, what I see when I'm driving down I-35 from my kids' sporting events in Gainesville, driving back down to Denton, Texas, practically in Oklahoma up there, and you see where that F3 tornado flew right through I-35 and took out gas stations and RV parks. And it's harrowing to see. But all of these things, what we see is the creation not producing for humanity, but we see the creation fighting against humanity, and yet not totally, only a third. But there is more than enough disease, disaster, and death to reveal, I think without a shadow of a doubt, that we live in a world that is presently under the judgment of God. Why judgment? What should we see? First, you and I, when we see those things in God's creation, we should see God's wrath. Kind of like a trailer for a movie. We've talked about this before. If that last day, that final day, the day of the Lord, when Christ comes again to judge the living and the dead, if that's the feature film, then all of these things are like trailers of that feature film, indicating what's to come, helping us to know and anticipate that day so that we might be able to respond responsibly. So first of all, we should see God's wrath in God's creation. Properly speaking, what this means is that there are no natural disasters in a world governed by God. Every natural disaster is a God-ordained disaster. Now, we're not going to stand up here, or I'm not going to stand up here, and you're not going to sit out there and try to presume on all of the many myriads of ways that God is working in and through disastrous and calamitous events. We don't have to understand all of the what's. We don't even have to have an answer to all of the whys, as long as we understand the who behind it. Because God is good. And all that He does is good. Even those things that are beyond our own comprehension. His hand is in it, and He intends it for good. Our own confession summarizes the Scripture's teaching really well on this. It says, God, the good creator of all things, in His infinite power and wisdom, upholds, directs, arranges, and governs all creatures and all things. What is it that falls under all creatures and all things? Well, Revelation 8, 6 through 12, that includes F3 tornadoes, Category 4 hurricanes, and city-leveling earthquakes. When we see those things, we should, on the one hand, be sorrowful for the reality of a world that is under God's wrath, groaning under His judgment, eagerly awaiting the revealing of the sons of God in their glory so that it might be transformed. But at the same time, we should see something of who God is in it, of what God thinks about sin, and of how and the kind of ways and the great extents to which He will go to wake us up to see ourselves for who we are in light of Him, to repent of our sins and our self-righteousness and our self-sufficiency, and to throw ourselves instead on the mercy of Christ for salvation. Secondly, why judgment? What we see is that ultimately the goal of God's wrath is our rescue. Moses said to Pharaoh, "Let my people go." Jesus, the greater Moses, said in Luke 21 that when disasters, quote, begin to take place, straighten up, raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Paul compares the creation to a woman giving birth. I know there's a number of y'all, so many of y'all, you can testify. You're good theologians when it comes to Romans 8. And creation groaning with birth pains. You know exactly what that means. We were talking about it today in family worship, but we won't go into the details. But when a pregnant woman has contractions, and they get stronger and they come with greater frequency, what does it mean? It means a baby is coming. And that means that on the other side of all of that pain and all that tribulation, there will be comfort and joy. That's what the creation is like under God's judgment. That's what the Bible teaches. Only instead of a baby, what follows is our redemption. It's judgment leading to joy. And so we're meant to understand the book this way. When we see judgment, we don't just read it as like judgment being an end in itself. It's a means to an end, and the end is your salvation and mine if we are in Christ. Well, just when you think things can't get any worse, in verse 13, we see an eagle circling the air as if looking for prey, announcing the final three trumpets. Notice, the first four trumpets had no woes attached to it. Those were pretty bad. But now, he's saying the next three trumpets, there is a woe to go along with every single one of them. He says, woe, woe, woe to those who dwell on the earth. If the first four trumpets focused on God's judgment against the earth itself, then these next three signify judgments against the earth dwellers. Three woes for three judgments against humanity, each one more intense than the one before, just like the contractions of a woman in labor. And that leads us to our second point in chapter 9. We just, within this context of beholding God's judgment, verses 1 through 9, consider evil run amok. Two woes are going to be present here. In verses 1 to 12, we're going to see a first woe. In the beginning of verse 13, we'll see a second woe. But look at verses 1 through 3. Just scan through that again. Put your eyeballs on it. The imagery is difficult, but all of it here is drawn from other parts of the Bible. The clues here tell us, I think, that we're talking about ultimately Satan and his forces. The star fallen from heaven, given a key to the shaft of a bottomless pit, authority to open it, all of that which comes out of it. You know, Isaiah 14 sees a star that fell from heaven. It was the king of Babylon. Babel, all the way back in Genesis chapter 11, and Babylon in the Bible, that is the most prominent image for the manifestation of evil. It speaks about humanity's coordinated efforts to rebel against God. It's going to have a prominent position in the second half of the letter as we continue to go through Revelation. And so it's an important image. Isaiah sees a star fell from heaven, the king of evil, the king of Babylon. Jesus uses the same image in Luke's gospel. He, quote, saw Satan fall like lightning or like a comet from heaven, like a falling star. And so here we have in verses 1 through 3, the ultimate king of Babylon, the king of all human rebellion, that is the devil, also called Satan. The Bible calls him the king of this world. Elsewhere, he's the prince of the power of the air. And here we see him cast down from heaven like a star cast down from the sky. And God gives him keys to the bottomless pit. Notice that what comes out of the pit, it seems like a monster movie. You seen any of the Godzilla movies? It's like evil kaijus crawling out of the deep to terrorize the surface. If you don't know what a kaiju is, just talk to Nate Wallace right afterwards. He'll talk to you for hours about it. He loves the kaijus. But it's like big monsters crawling out from the depths onto the surface to terrorize the world. But notice the vision doesn't stop there. No, because in verses 7 to 10, the horror movie continues. Terrifying imagery. In appearance, the locusts were like horses prepared for battle, and their heads were what looked like crowns of gold, their faces like human faces. The hair like women's hair and the teeth like lion's teeth. They had breastplates like breastplates of iron, and the noise of their wings was like the noise of many chariots with horses rushing in a battle. They have tails and stings like scorpions, and their power to hurt people for 5 months is in their tails. All of this, you may recall, we see in the Old Testament. It recalls the plague of locusts against Egypt from Exodus chapter 10. It thinks also about perhaps the prophet Joel's words when he describes God's coming judgment in terms of invading locusts. Joel chapter 2, he describes these locusts, quote, as war horses in the same way that we see here, bringing flames and destruction. He compares them to, quote, fierce warriors who charge and, quote, soldiers who scale walls and battlements. My youngest daughter is reading the Ingalls Wilder books. Little House on the Prairie, anybody? Show of hands, Little House on the Prairie, you know what I'm talking about. They're in On the Banks of Plum Creek right now. And in the banks of Plum Creek, I didn't even know this existed because I'm not as well read as my 7-year-old. We read through these passages and we were talking about locusts, and it was just like in Little House. On the banks of Plum Creek, when the wheat was ready to cut, the Ingalls family saw a cloud off in the distance. And as they were looking up at the cloud, wondering where it was coming from and what it was going to do, something plunked Laura right in the face. And it was the biggest grasshopper that she had ever seen. The cloud, it says, was hailing grasshoppers. The cloud was grasshoppers. Their bodies hid the sun and made darkness. And then as the chapter goes on, they are all over everything, underfoot, in the clothes, in the hair. You can see the eyes, claws on your skin, all of those kind, and it addresses it in vivid detail. And quote, it says, Laura tried to beat them off, but their claws clung to her skin and her dress, and they looked at her with bulging eyes, turning their heads this way and that. Anybody else get the creeps yet? Goodness gracious. And then the sound of destruction. Quote, millions and millions of grasshoppers were eating now. You could hear millions of jaws biting and chewing. The author says it even filled the girls' imaginations. In bed, Laura and Mary would still hear the whirring, the snipping, and the chewing. Laura felt claws crawling on her. In the dark, she saw grasshoppers' bulging eyes and felt their claws crawling until she went to sleep. Even when they weren't on her, they felt on her. Even when they weren't around her, she could still see them. It is evil run amok. You can't escape it. Everywhere it lands, it destroys, and it is like millions of jaws biting and chewing. Later on in the book, Pa, the dad, sees them all get up and they march away, new grasshopper babies. Hatch from their eggs and they line up like an army and they march away to the west. And Paul remarked that it seemed like somebody was telling them where to go and what to do. Well, we know that we shouldn't take this kind of imagery literally because John uses the word like over and over and over again. It's like this, it's like that. And so using this Old Testament pencil, John is drawing a theological portrait of evil. Evil is similar in verse 7, or familiar rather. It's familiar to us. Verse 7, it has human faces. It's seductive, like the beautiful woman in verse 8. Or you might even think about the beautiful woman in the first few chapters of the Proverbs. It's seductive. Not only that, verse 9, it's powerful as if wearing breastplates of iron. In verse 10, it's hostile, that it stings with a scorpion's tail, and perhaps most frighteningly, it is intelligent. It follows orders, and according to verse 11, it has a king telling it where to go and what to do, just like Paul thought. Look at verse 11. It says here that the king's name in Greek was Apollyon, destroyer. Let me give you just a little bit of historical context. Apollo was a Roman god worshipped at the time of John's writing. Apollo's symbol, we know from archaeological evidence, Apollo's symbol was that of a locust. And the emperor Domitian, in the latter part of the first century, responsible for the most ruthless persecution of Christians in the history of the Roman Empire, claimed to be an incarnation of Apollo. All the emperors had high views of themselves. All the emperors believed themselves to be some kind of incarnation of the Roman gods. It's why they expected themselves to be worshipped by the empire. Domitian claimed to be the incarnation of Apollo, and what did he choose as his own symbol? But a locust. John's writing in a way that makes sense to his audience. They would have spotted the likeness of the emperor in John's vision in a heartbeat, because it was under Domitian's reign that they were experiencing the persecution that they were enduring. But it's not just addressing what happened back then, because what happened under Domitian, let's call him the grasshopper king, Apollyon, is what happens in every age of the church until Christ returns, is it not? There's always another Domitian. There's always another locust king. Whether in North Korea or China, whether in Sudan or in any other part of the world, there's always another locust king that rages against its creator, hating God, hating the gospel, and raging against the church. Well, Satan doesn't always show up looking like a locust or a scorpion, as he might in a CGI monster movie. But he may show up as an emperor. He may show up as a warlord. He might even show up as a president. He'll be an attractive and destructive political force, commanding millions of biting and chewing jaws, and destroys everything he touches. And Revelation 9 teaches us that these are not accidental evils. They may be intelligent, but it is not accidental. It is not ultimate. Satanic powers that we see here in Revelation 8 and 9 are but God's instrument to judge this wicked world and to accomplish all of his gospel promises in Christ. We have an election coming up. Some of you in here may be looking at it and you're thinking, how do I make this choice? Am I going to choose between Egypt or Babylon? Which is better? I want to suggest that when you look at our own culture and our own country, in light of Revelation, just like the rest of the world, we are by and large a country that is presently under the judgment of God. And it is meant for the preservation of the church and the proclamation of the gospel and the salvation of all of God's elect as it's proclaimed in this place. Those are the purposes for God's judgment, not just here, not just in our own world, but everywhere. But that's just the first woe. Notice in verse 13 and following, the second is even worse. Oh, it just keeps getting worse. In verse 14, John sees mounted troops, rather, standing by the Euphrates. You see that there? The Euphrates was a river running through Babylon. We're back to Babylon again. Babylon's back in focus, and it will be more and more as the book goes on. It is, as I said earlier, a symbol of human pride united in rebellion against God. Well, here we see that the satanic spirit of Babylon wears many masks, and this will be true throughout the book. And most of them are not supernatural. It's going to look like wicked kings. It's going to look like political tyranny. It's going to look like godless compromise. And it's going to look like normalized sexual immorality. But above all, Babylon hates God. And it wants to deceive and destroy the church in its attempts to be its own God. Verses 15 to 19. Here we see an army every bit as supernatural and demonic as the locust plague. Verse 16, the number of mounted troops was twice 10,000 times 10,000. That's around 200 million for you math majors. If I'm wrong and you're a math major, don't tell me afterwards. It's a vast host, the point is. Beyond counting, you two, I'm looking at you. Two people studied math and got married. Y'all are dangerous. It's a vast host beyond counting. Larger than any earthly army, even by present standards. Verses 70 to 19, John sees horses with riders, and boy, do they have some bad breath. Look at this. They have lions' heads, but they have serpents' tails. They come in, projecting themselves as a Messiah, but they go out like the great dragon. And that explains then the fire and the sulfur and the smoke that accompany these riders. One commentator put it this way: this is an army straight from the jaws of hell. The snake-like tails of horses indicate their satanic nature, and so do the fire, smoke, and sulfur, which they excel. That is a terrifying image of evil run amok in the world. And we can think from our own perspective that evil has run amok and is out of control. The good news of Revelation 8 and 9 is that no evil, no satanic power, nothing in this world can move a single inch apart from God's say-so and according to God's purposes. If you do not have a high view of the sovereignty of God, and you think he's just back there, a slave to the free will of man in such a way that he's just kind of hoping that we avail ourselves of the grace that we need to make this world a little bit better, that is a depressing theology. What ultimately brings comfort to the saints is that in a world that seems, from our perspective, like it is out of control, Revelation 4, from the perspective of God's throne room, the raging sea, from an earthly perspective, is as still as glass. He is sovereign. Everything that happens, happens by his will and for his purposes, and it happens for our good, that he would redeem us and sanctify us and rescue us. And so what we see, if we learn anything from these passages, is that God is angry at sin. He's not angry like a fitful toddler. He's angry like a righteous king. He's angry at men and women who reject him and suppress knowledge of him, despite all of the ways that he's revealed himself and what he has made in Christ and in his word. He's angry over the suffering that the world inflicts on his church, just like Egypt and Babylon did back in the day. But don't make a mistake, God doesn't take pleasure in judgment like some kind of sadist. That's not what we're saying. He is good, and all that he does is good, and God is good to judge evil. Amen? And he is good to use evil to judge evil. Amen? Revelation 8 and 9, they are warning shots across the bow. This is not the final judgment, but it's coming. He is right now revealing his wrath in these ways in order that he might, by his great grace, save some and rescue his church through the ages. And so perhaps you're here and you are not a Christian. You're just here investigating Christian things. What a day to show up to our church. Locusts and scorpion tails and whatnots. And yet in all these calamities that these fantastical pictures represent, I want to impress upon you that what you're seeing, what you're hearing as I preach, this is God as He really is. You know, deep down, just as every single one of us at one point knew deep down, that you deserve God's wrath because you have rebelled against Him. And in your disregard for His word, or in your ambivalence toward the gospel, or how you love your sin, even at the expense of other people around you, to you, in spite of your sin, and in light of all of the wrath that we see poured out on creation, God is offering you today salvation in Christ. Only a third, a third, a third, a third, there's hope. There is mercy in Christ. That if you turn to Him in repentance and faith, He will seal you for salvation by the blood of Jesus Christ, the Lamb who is slain for sinners like you and like me. And unlike those that we see in chapter 9, verse 5, those without the seal of God, you will have a safe refuge in Christ forever. You will be untouched. You will be purified by God's wrath and judgment, but you will not ultimately be harmed. You have safety and security in Him, and you will be brought all the way through judgment into abundance and joy by the Good Shepherd, who will be your joy and your treasure forever. What is so valuable in this world that you would forfeit that to hold on to? What pride is worth holding on? What self-sufficiency is worth holding on to reject an offer like that? That's what He offers you in Christ. But even so, despite that offer, we behold in verses 20 and 21, how much more sinners would rather endure wrath and die in their sins than behold the glory of God and His wrath and justice and repent and receive eternal life in Christ. The rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues did not repent of the works of their hands. What was ultimately the goal of God's sovereign working of these judgments in history right now? In the centuries before us, and should Christ delay in the centuries to follow, what is His goal? That the rest of mankind would repent. That they would see trailers of a judgment yet to come, and they would not think themselves sufficient to stand in that day, but they would turn to Christ. But here it says, the rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues, here's what happens. In every age of the church, despite God's wrath being poured out on humanity, they did not repent of the works of their hands, nor give up worshiping demons and idols of gold and silver and bronze and stone and wood, which cannot see or hear or walk. They give themselves to gods that are impotent and speechless and powerless, and they deny the Creator of the universe, nor do they repent of their murders and their sorceries, their sexual immoralities and their thefts. Why? Because they love those things more than the Savior. They see filth in Christ, folly in Christ. And in all of these things, they see wisdom and power. The word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to those of us who are being saved, it is the power of God. What we see in 20 and 21 is the gospel as foolishness to those who are perishing. You would think that a world given over to environmental and political catastrophe and countless sins against humanity, you would think that it would be obvious to the world that there's something wrong with the world. You would think that they would instinctively think the God who rules this world is angry with us. You would think that they'd come to their senses and urgently repent of their sins to seek mercy from the one and true and living God in Christ. And yet many don't. They double down in their rebellion. One of the things that stands out about our own 24-hour news cycles is how it can show, on the one hand, unspeakable horrors, and then turn around at the same time and speak with unbridled optimism about the progress of mankind. Incredible self-confidence in our ability to fix this world without God. As I was writing the sermon in the back booth of Panera, I'm not going to tell you which one because I don't want you hunting me down. I was there to write a sermon. And I looked over, and while I'm writing my sermon, and written in permanent marker on the wall, as people who love God and society or want to do, said, quote, "Give God a break, we can save ourselves." That is the banner of verses 20 and 21. We don't need God. We have everything that we need in and of ourselves to save ourselves. How long can we hold together this optimism in the face of God's obvious judgments? Revelation says there's no end to it. People won't repent because sin makes us spiritually blind and deaf. This world is just like Pharaoh. God sends plagues, God sends death and darkness, and still mankind will not repent but continues to rage against God despite evidence of his mercy and his power. What are we to make of that? It'd be a bad way to end a sermon. What's remarkable is that this is not the worst woe. There's one more woe, a seventh trumpet, and a third woe. Whenever you read any of these cycles in Revelation, like this one, beginning in verse 8 or chapter 8, going all the way to chapter 11, really you need to read it beginning to end, understand it in context, because you always have two things present in all of these cycles. You have tribulation and triumph. What is tribulation going to be like, and what does it look like for God's people in this present age to endure and persevere by faith in Christ? Tribulation. And how will God triumph at the end of the age? We need to understand Revelation 8 and 9 in light, all this tribulation in light of God's triumph. Look at this, chapter 11, the end of the section, beginning in verse 14, the second woe is past. Behold, the third woe is soon to come. And then the angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, "The kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever." And the 24 elders who sit on the thrones before God fell on their faces, and they worshiped God, saying, "We give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, who is and who was, for you have taken your great power, and you have begun to reign. The nations raged, but your wrath came, and the time for the dead to be judged, and for rewarding your servants, the prophets and the saints, and those who fear your name, both small and great, and for destroying the destroyers of the earth." Then God's temple in heaven was opened, and the ark of his covenant was seen within his temple, and there were flashes of lightning, rumblings, peal of thunder, and an earthquake, and heavy hail. The first woe was bad, the second was even worse, but the third is cataclysmic. Because the only thing more terrifying than falling into the hands of a hellish army is to fall into the hands of the living God. Just like the seventh seal that we saw back at the beginning of chapter 8, verse 1, the seventh trumpet introduces a deafening heavenly silence. All of heaven in awe of God's judgments. And in verse 15, we see Satan's dominion is over. He no longer runs around unrestrained. His locust-like scorpions are defeated. All those who rebelled against God and his Christ will be swept away. And the glory of Christ's kingdom fills the whole earth like the waters fill the seas, with Christ reigning forever on the throne. And then in verses 16 and 17, notice the language that the elders use to describe the Lamb. They describe him as one who was and who is. Earlier in the book, in Revelation chapter 1, he was described as the one who is and who was and who is to come. But here he is not described as the one who is to come. Why? Because he has come. And he has won. His triumph is filling the earth. Verse 18, this is what the newsreels will look like on that day. It won't look anything like our newsreels. Human optimism will not be anywhere present. Believing in human progress in spite of the horrors of our age will be nowhere to be found. Our only optimism and hope will be found in Christ. When we look at the news today, we see terrible turmoil. It's a wake-up call for people to repent. The trumpets make us look back on John's audience. They help us to see the way things were is the way things will always be in this present age. But it also makes us look forward to a future day, a final day when the world is judged with judgments that make the previous two woes seem light and small. If you think the world is bad now, wait until the Lord Jesus Christ shows up on a white horse with a sword coming out of his mouth. It'll make the previous woes seem light by comparison, and none will escape except those who stand in Christ. All of God's sealed servants who've endured the tribulation of this life, when we read Revelation 8 and 9, what we learn is that God's wrath, his justice, is our reward. It is our vindication. It is our liberation from this world. It's the end of the world. The end of every so-called Apollyon. It is the end of evil. We give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, who is and who was, for you have taken your great power and begun to reign. Here's the message of Romans 8 and 9. This world, though it may seem so to us, is not out of control. God is in control. Satan is not winning, and he cannot win. God has him on a leash to serve his purposes in the world, and there will be justice. You can bank on it. Let's pray.